This is the first video in the scaphoid fracture series. In this video, we will study about the anatomy, vascular supply, the various examination findings, radiology, and the classification of the scaphoid fracture. Now, to begin with the scaphoid anatomy of the scaphoid bone, it is the one of the most common and one of the most important carpal bones of our hand. It lies in line with the thumb, forming the base of the thumb. And laterally, it articulates with the trapezium and the trochanter. Medially, it articulates with the capitate and the lunate. And inferiorly, it articulates with the radius bone. The orientation of the scaphoid bone is very important. As we can see here, there is a distal part, a proximal part, and in between, there is an area known as waist of the scaphoid bone. Now, this distal part, it is a bit of in bit of pronation, ulnar deviation, and flexion. So this distal part is in pronation, flexion, and the ulnar deviation as compared to the proximal part. Now talking about the various parts of the scaphoid bone. So this is the articulating part which articulates with the capitate bone. So this will lie over the medial aspect and this will be the lateral aspect. So this forms the scaphoid bone of the right hand. So the various part, we have the distal pole, we have the proximal pole, and in between we have the waist. And over this is the dorsoradial surface. The distal pole has a tuberosity of the scaphoid bone. And the fractures are more common over the waist of the scaphoid bone. Now coming upon to the when the patient present to us in the emergency, there are three things that will lead us to the diagnosis of the scaphoid fracture. So history examination are equally important as the X-ray findings to diagnose the scaphoid fractures. Now before that, we will study about the vascular supply of the scaphoid bone, which is very important as this is the bone which usually goes into the avascular necrosis. So as we can see here, we have the dorsal side and we have the volar side here. Now dorsal side, over the dorsal side, we have the major supply, which is from the branch of the radial artery. So there is a branch of the radial artery known by the name of the dorsal branch of the radial artery, which supplies the proximal part of the scaphoid bone. About 70 to 80% of the scaphoid bone is supplied by the dorsal branch of the radial artery. And over the palmar aspect, we have the superficial volar branch of the radial artery, which supplies rest of the 20 to 30%, and the distal part of the scaphoid bone. So we have the dorsal branch of the radial artery, which will supply the proximal part, proximal 80% part of the scaphoid bone via retrograde supply. And we have the superficial palmar branch, which supplies the rest of the 20% of the scaphoid. Because of this region, as we can see here, the proximal pole is least supplied by the arterial supply. So the avascular necrosis of the proximal pole fractures is more common, followed by the waist, and rarely the distal pole goes into the avascular necrosis. Now coming upon to the history. Now the patient will present with to us with the typical history over the fall on the outstretched hand with wrist in extension and the radial deviation. So when the patient falls like this, the scaphoid fractures are common. After the history, we will go for the examination. So we have the various points in examination which can lead to the scaphoid fracture. So first is the anatomical snuff box tenderness might be there. Then scaphoid tubercle tenderness can be there. Scaphoid tubercle is palpated over the volar aspect. Then on longitudinal thumb compression, there may be pain at the scaphoid region. Then patient may complain of the reduced or painful thumb movement. There may be pain at this anatomical snuff box in radial or ulnar deviation. And lastly, there may be pain over the thumb and the pinch movement. There may be pain over this region. So if the patient comes to us with this history and it has few points, positive points on examination, we should think of the scaphoid. Now we have, for scaphoid fracture, we have the various x-rays, as the carpal bones are very tightly fitted. So diagnosis on x-ray is difficult to make. So we will go for the three basic views, which is the PA view, lateral view and the oblique view. Other than these three basic view, we have the four special views. So first view is the PA view in ulnar deviation. So this is the first view. Posterior anterior view in ulnar deviation. Then we can have the ulnar oblique view in 45 degree. Then we can have a radial oblique view in 45 degree. And lastly, we can have the zitter view. Zitter view is the PA view in ulnar deviation, but the beam is angled at 20 degree to the elbow. So we go like this. Beam is angled like this and the wrist is in ulnar deviation. So it is a PA view, but the beam is angled at 20 degree. So these are the 3-4 views that can help us in the diagnosis of the scaphoid fractures. So this is the PA view. This is the same PA view in ulnar deviation, then lateral, and we can go for the oblique views, 45 degree oblique views. Now, other than the x-rays, we can go for CT scan and the MRI, but we should know that what to look for the CT scan and what are indication for the CT scan and MRI. Now it is noted that MRI is sensitive for the occult fracture, which are less than 24 hours. So if we are suspecting for the scaphoid fractures and it is an acute injury and only 24 hours has passed from the trauma, we should go for the MRI, because it is more sensitive for the occult fractures. And also MRI is used for look for the vascularity status, to look for the avascular necrosis. And for CT scan, we can look for the location of fracture to classify the fracture, whether it is a waist fracture, proximal pole or the distal pole fracture. We can look for the size of the fragments and we can look for the progression of union after operative or non-operative management and the extent of collapse. So which we will be discussing in the upcoming video, the collapse of the scaphoid bone. So these are the few indications for the MRI and the CT scan. Really, a bone scan can also be done if no positive findings are found on these x-rays and MRIs. Bone scan can be done to look for the uptake in this region and to classify it as a scaphoid fracture. Now lastly, we will study about the classification of the scaphoid fracture. So broadly, it is classified into type A, which is a acute fracture, but a stable fracture. So this is the type A, which is a acute and stable fracture. So A1 is the fracture of tubercle and A2 is the fracture through the waist, but they are stable and acute fracture. Then type B, we can have the unstable fracture. So B1 is the distal fracture, B2 is the waist fracture, B3 is the proximal pole fracture, and B4 is the fracture dislocation, which is transcaphoid perilunate fracture dislocation of the carpal bones. So A1, it was stable and acute fracture. In B, it is unstable and acute fractures. B1 is the distal, B2 is waist, and B3 is the proximal pole fracture, and B4 is the fracture dislocation. Now, type C and type D are the chronic. So in type C, it is a delayed union. So it is classified as type C if the more than 6 weeks has passed since the injury and we are suspecting for the delayed union. And in type D, it is established case of non-union. Now it can be a fibrous union, D1, or it can be pseudoarthrosis at the fracture site, which is classified as D2. So this is the broad classification by the name of Herbert classification. Type A and B are the acute fracture, Type C and D are the chronic injuries. So that was about the introductory video to the scaphoid fracture. So important is the to know the anatomy of the scaphoid bone. So we can revise it here. So we have the distal pole, we have the proximal pole, we have the waist here, we have a tuberosity in the distal region. We should know about the vascular supply. So vascular supply is mostly over the dorsal aspect here in this groove, from where the dorsal carpal branch of the radial artery supplies the proximal part, 80% of the proximal part. And over the volar aspect, we have the superficial palmar branch, which supplies the rest of the 20% and the distal part of the scaphoid bone. Now it is important to know that why it goes into the non-union and avascular necrosis later on. So it is because the entire scaphoid bone, about 80% of the scaphoid bone, is covered by the articular cartilage, and there is no scope of the periosteal healing in this region. So because of that, the non-union are very common and avascular necrosis are equally common. And over the dorsal radial aspect, we have the dorsal branch of carpal bone plus all the ligamentous attachment to the scaphoid bone, which can be scapholunate ligament or scaphocarpal or intercarpal ligament. They all are attached over this dorsal radial aspect. So that was about the introduction to the scaphoid fracture. Thank you.